hymn that is not traditional in the Lutheran Church, but it's such a beautiful hymn with great words. I thought I would let you know what the words are for the first verse in the chorus. It's called The Love of God. It's by Frederick Lehman. And it's in public domain, but this arrangement isn't, so it won't be on the recording. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care, God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his sin. O love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall forevermore endure the saints' and angels' song.
Come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I thereby declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
That you know. Nourish our souls with your body and blood. Let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. Hallelujah. Happy are they who fear the Lord and have great delight in God's commandments.
Their descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed.
Wealth and riches will be in their house, and their righteousness will last forever.
Light shines in the darkness for the upright. The righteous are merciful and full of compassion.
It is good for them to be generous in lending and to manage their affairs with justice.
For they will never be shaken.
is steadfast, trusting in the Lord.
Their heart is established and will not shrink until they see their desire upon their enemies.
They have given freely to the poor, and their righteousness stands fast forever. They will hold up their head with honor.
The wicked will see it and be angry. They will gnash their teeth and bow away. The desires of the wicked will perish.
The second reading is written in Hebrews, the 13th chapter. Let mutual love continue. Do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, that some have entertained angels without knowing. Remember those who are in prison as though you were in prison with them. Those who are being tortured as though you yourselves were being tortured. Let marriage be held in honor by all, and let the marriage bed be kept undefiled, for God will judge fornicators and adulterers. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we can say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can anyone do to me? Remember your leaders, those who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. Through him, then, let us continually offer a sacrifice of praise to God that is the fruit of lips that confess his name. Do not neglect to do good and to share what you have, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. The word of the Lord. By someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit at the place of honor in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come to you and say, give this person your place, and then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends, for your brothers, for your relatives, or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous, the good news of Christ.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
Good and gracious God, I pray your continued presence with us. Holy Spirit, have your way. In Jesus' name.
commandment.
So in our gospel text today, we find ourselves at a banquet. And this is the section of Luke where Jesus is journeying to Jerusalem. And in this section, we find a lot of examples of food, banquet, and his restating his mission to the poor. Earlier in the book of Luke, Jesus reads from the Isaiah scroll saying that he came to bring good news to the poor and freedom for the prisoners. I'm going to talk about those two things that are relevant for our banquet and our Lucan text today. Good news to the poor. The Hebrew word that's referenced here, ani, it doesn't just mean people without money, or as we would say today, those with fiscal challenges. It also includes those who back then were deemed to be lower in status, as our text relates, those who were crippled, those who were women, those who were not representative of the dominant culture. Those people are referenced in that word for the poor, people who were marginalized and consequently oppressed. And if Jesus says, I come to bring good news for the poor, then those are the people for whom the good news is especially good. As a nephew of mine said, it's gooder for them. And then he says, I'm bringing freedom to the prisoner. The Greek word for freedom is aphesis, which really means to release. And Jesus says, I come to bring release from those who are in bondage. It was a reference to the Jubilee celebration in the Old Testament, where in the year of Jubilee, people who were enslaved would be released. Any debt would be canceled. If family land had to be sold, it would be returned. The important part of release is that it is meant for both those persons who were in bondage and those who were doing the binding. So in our banquet for today, we find people jockeying for seats of honor. I believe that those people were in bondage to power and wanted to have it manifested and shown and seen by everybody by where they sat. And I find that truly interesting. Now, fair, in all fairness, I have 2,000 years of scholarly wisdom for me to find it fascinating, but I think that maybe if I were a Pharisee, I might not find it interesting. I might find it confusing and upsetting. Consider that these are the highest level of a people who were told that they were chosen by God. These are people who were to be consecrated, set apart, and in human parlance, that generally means above, right? And so now, after all of this time, the long-awaited Messiah says, you're all the same. The long-awaited Messiah says, you shouldn't really entertain having a seat of honor. That's gotta be confusing for people who have spent their lives believing, although maybe not delivered from God, but believing that there was a higher ranking. Imagine what their thoughts were as they tried to process this, right? I've done everything I was supposed to do. I have obeyed the law. I followed the commands, mostly. And now the grace, which I've been waiting for that should belong to me and me exclusively, the grace that I deserve, is now freely given to everybody? We can empathize with that though, right? I mean, when we have strived to achieve something, social status or tenure or a position in a corporation, and suddenly the playing field is level, great. Everybody's a director of finance now. That which we work for and is now given to everyone, if that were to happen to us, we be a little bit off kilter. But I think that's the whole point of Jesus' message. It upends social order. And at the banquet in our text, the firsts were jockeying to remain seen as first. But in the text, Jesus has two directives. That we not sit in the place of honor so that we won't be embarrassed, and to remember to invite the poor. I believe, as I said, that Jesus came to release not those who were just lowly, but also those who deemed themselves higher. I think Jesus came to release the powerful from the bondage of power and to bring the good news of provision to the poor. In this text, Jesus also reminds us of that upside down, topsy-turvy world that he mentions in the Sermon on the Mount. But in here he says, "For the exalted themselves will be humbled, and the humble will be exalted." The best way for me to imagine this has been like a pendulum. Right? I don't think of it like a continuum, like exalted, not exalted, poor and rich. But I think of it like a pendulum swinging. And if the first is to be last, and then the last is to be first, that makes more sense to me. And I want to hold on to that imagery for just a second. Because I think the reason we hear about this upside-down servant leadership world so often is that we can't get ourselves out of our own way. We refuse to let go of what I've done, what I've sacrificed for. And we, like those early Christians, forget that we are saved by grace alone. Unfortunately, we too often sound like the law. We worked for it, they should too. That sounds dangerously close to earning grace, right? And so because of this mentality, the Bible states and restates this pendulum-like phrases. The first will be last, the last will be poor. And in thinking about today's text, what occurred to me in this image is that, well, the rich are being poor and the poor, there are two things happening at the same time. And what happens when you leave a pendulum alone? Eventually, it rests in stasis all together. And I think that's the community. That's the banquet. That's the table for all when we consider ourselves not high or separated or above, but in stasis together. That is the kingdom of heaven. And it is the grace of the kingdom that we all too often forget. And we forget that Jesus came for that freedom, for that release. We have been recipients of the release from that debt we can never, ever repay. And so that brings me to recent events when the world literally, well, the United States, split in two after the announcement of President Biden's loan forgiveness program. In an instant, it seemed as though we were in two camps. I reposted something on Facebook, a picture that said something like, "I swear the world is divided into two halves. One half saying, I had to go through it, and you should too. And the other half saying, I had to go through it, but I'm going to do everything I can to make sure you don't have to." 2,000 years later, we were still representing the two camps we find in the banquet at Luke. Now again, I emphasize that I want to restate that I can understand the Pharisees' feeling on the journey because it is difficult to walk into something new, and much less to remain in something new, something that's different from what we understand the way things are supposed to be. And that's the way it is, I think, with people who object to student loan forgiveness. In Luke, the Pharisaic faction, or the law faction, says, "I did it, I had to earn it, and you should too." But the grace faction says, "Partake in the provision." And so today, The law faction still says, I had to pay, so you should too. But the grace faction says, praise God, I am so glad we were able to remove that stumbling block from your path. Would that we would all not be brood of vipers and hypocrites. As followers in Christ, we must embrace and embody the grace and the release and all of the banquet's provision. And it must shine through in our actions and in our words. I ask that we consider, as we navigate through the next weeks, remember the two factions and which side you align with. As you shape your conversations and social media, remember the vision of the pendulum and remember that only at stasis is it in community, and only at stasis is it representative of the kingdom of God. And remember, as we gather here, that we gather to celebrate release of debt. And may we be able to carry that forward with us. In the matchless, marvelous, and magnanimous name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Share our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth.
I believe
in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again.
Trusting in God's extraordinary love, let us come near to the Holy One in prayer. For the church and its leaders, we pray. Uphold all deacons, pastors, and bishops who serve and teach your people. Awaken in your church a spirit of invitation that reaches ever outward. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
For the well-being of creation and its inhabitants, we pray. Stir in us reverent awe for the beauty of the natural world, for oceans and lakes and rivers and streams and forests and deserts. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
For the nations and peoples of the world, we pray. Sustain the efforts of those who pursue justice and equality for all. Defend and accompany all immigrants and refugees and all who are persecuted for their ethnic origin or religious beliefs. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
For all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, we pray. Be present with those who live in isolation or fear, especially those who are incarcerated or detained. Comfort all who are sick or grieving, especially Pam, Bill, Scott, Carla, Seth, DJ, Margaret, Sister Mary, George, Arlene and Greg, Billy, Dave, and the family of Ruth Hoy. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
For this congregation and its ministries, we pray. Prepare children, teachers, and youth ministry directors for a new year of learning. Embolden our witness to invite others to the table. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
We ask your attendance to those that create laws of this nation, its counties, boroughs, and cities. Help them to remember a call to freedom. Protect the children currently under fire as they suffer through limited reading material or potential lack of funds to help them navigate gender fluidity. Strengthen us to have the courage of our convictions and use voting power to rally around those and elect those who walk in mercy and who fight for justice for all. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
For all the saints who confessed God's name, may we cling to the promise of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Merciful God,
receive our prayers.
May the prayers of your children, merciful God, keep and hold us forever in your steadfast love. Through Jesus Christ, our holy wisdom.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We share a socially distanced sign of peace. Let us pray. God of all creation, all that you have made is good, and your love endures forever. You bring forth bread from earth and fruit from the vine. Nourish us with these gifts, that we will be for the world signs of your gracious presence in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
We will recite the dialogue responsively. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you. And so with all the choirs of angels and with the church on earth and with the hosts of heaven, we pray your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord.
Oh.
remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it to all, saying, "Drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me."
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Shine upon you and be gracious to you. The The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.